and arrow, there was somebody there waiting to meet some farmers from Canada, Saskatchewan, who had come in, and they go and stay with a host family on their farm and share knowledge back and forth.
But then, and then there's always also meetings between Cuban farmers and other Cuban farmers. I'm not sure if that's, there's an organization named that, but it's like what goes on.
Is organic versus non-organic farming, is there any kind of geographic distribution to that? Meaning the west more organic than the east, or is it pretty much?
I think it was more the type of crop, because I know sugar cane wasn't organic.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Because we didn't plan to visit them, but we stopped and looked at some sugar cane along the highway, and that wasn't organic.
Okay.
They were still using fertilizers.
And what percentage of that is, like sugar cane, is it a small percentage, a big percentage of the
I think it's a fair amount of it, because that's actually an export.
Yeah.
So it's the way they get foreign exchange.
I don't know what percent of like the arable land in Cuba is sugar cane.
Right.
Of like we were told that of food crops, then 80% of food is grown organically. But sugar cane, I don't know if it would be considered a food and included in that 80% or not. It wasn't totally clear.
Right.
Another thing that stuck with us was the prevalence of urban agriculture and organoponicos, and even in Havana, like I just walking down the street, I saw like a balcony with a banana tree growing on it, and so there's just a lot of, or another like a small, what drew me to that art street in Havana was that there was a field with goats right in downtown Havana, so there's just a lot of like urban agriculture integrated with where people live, and especially organoponicos that are like a government-sanctioned enterprise or initiative where the government will support them with research and with, like, the one thing I noticed is lots of different types of microorganisms that they would knowingly use that would be really rare in Canada for people to know so much about different types of microorganisms that they're using for biocontrol or to promote growth or things like that. But I think, as I mentioned before, organoponicos are like usually small areas where they're like raised beds built from compost, and the compost tends to be stuff that's collected locally. Like they might like there would be horses pulling carriages in the street, and then the horse manure would be collected and used in compost, and then eventually, after it has, like not directly, but after it's composted for a long time, would be used in the bed or other organic matter that would be collected locally.
And just about every place we saw was using vermicomposting for animal waste.
Mm-hmm. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later, and then Heather can talk about this part.
So the organoponicos were basically these plots of land in urban areas that the government had given over to typically groups of local people. And the deal was that they could grow food on the land and earn an income from it, but they have to produce some produce that is going to go to things like schools and daycares and senior centers. So that in exchange for having access to that land and making a living on it, they're meeting some of the government's needs to provide food for these institutions. Mm-hmm. This was the Vivero Alomar in Havana. So it's this big co-op. It's actually, it's a UBPC. It's a unit of basic.
Is it in English? It would be a unit of basic agricultural production.
Yeah, but there's cooperative in there.
Oh, basic agricultural.
So UBPC was a cooperative. And so this one was really big. It's been around for 14 years, and they have been given more and more land by the state as they've gone forward. So they have currently 181 members. They started off with four. The person who gave us this tour was in fact one of the original four. So of that 181 people, 60 are seniors. people in the local community, and one of the things that they were saying about the seniors is it gives them something useful to do, and they have a really good work ethic. And so they really liked having the seniors there. Again, they provide organic produce for the community, they sell it. And they decided that they needed to move away from egalitarianism to really make this a productive enterprise. And so what they do is everybody who comes into the co-op gets a share. And then the longer you stay, the more shares you have. They pay a dividend on shares weekly. And then on top of that, they pay you a percentage of whatever profit the co-op has that week. So there is that incentive to work hard and make it work. I know that I asked the question that, you know, so do you just take anybody who applies? And they said no, that there are so many now that they only take in people who have the skills that they need. So at that point, they were looking for somebody who knew goat husbandry. So if anybody knows that, you could go to Havana and have a membership in the co-op. And again, the government makes this land available to them because they're going to produce food for the community.
So was there a percentage of the crop that had to go to the government?
I'm not too sure how that's all.
I think there was a percent. I think there was a quota. Like it didn't have to go to just the government as a whole, but it would be like, well, you have to give so many tons of stuff to this senior center and so many tons to this daycare, and then anything above that you get to keep. I think it was more like that than a percentage.
So we've just heard about how they provide these incentives for people to work hard, and we see this guy asleep in the warehouse, and we walk by him again later, and he's still there.
We heard that the tobacco, what everybody grows tobacco, is a huge extra crop.
And that's another that they use pesticides on.
Yeah. The government takes a huge percentage of it.
Yeah.
In fact, I mean,
yeah.
Well, and I think for the co-op, I think somebody asked what happens if they don't, like they have this quota, what happens if you don't even make this quota? Then I think they said, well, then you have to buy or borrow crops from someone else. You have to buy it and then give it to the government. So you could, if you did really badly, you could end up in the negative. Like if it goes well, it can be really great, but there is that risk. Like it's not that if you don't, if you do really badly, then
so one of the farms that we visited specialized in medicinal plants. During the special period, they didn't have the trade relationship with the USSR. They, you know, they couldn't trade with the US. They didn't have foreign exchange, so pharmaceuticals were in short supply. So they started developing their knowledge about the use of medicinal plants and how to grow them. So this farm that we visited was 325 hectares, and currently they grow 336 species on it. It was established in 1986 by a man, Diego Otero, and he established this and developed it with his family. He had a lot of people coming to him over the years to be treated with these. I mean, he treated a whole long list of various ailments.
Mm-hmm.
He was actually asked by Fidel to rescue the knowledge of medicinal plants, so there was some traditional knowledge. There's actually a really interesting story about this man. He came, his parents came from Spain in 1914. His mother was a doctor, and they lived in a cave for 8 years. And so I think they did have this awareness of sort of the value traditional medicine. So his son's running it now. His son was actually asked by the government to continue on for his father, which typically jobs aren't passed on in a family like that, but because they're finding a hard time getting people to work on this, they feel as though it has to be people who are really committed to the idea of doing this. So the son is running it, and right now they grow the plants, they supply them to the public health ministry labs for research, and then they go to pharmacies for natural remedies. And we were always really impressed by the technology and innovation that we saw in various places. Some of it a little bit scary. But right here, whoops, right here, this was just a drip irrigation system. They had a pot bottle that was being slowly filled up, and once it filled to a certain level, it would tip. And then they used IV equipment. It would just slowly drip the water out. And then this guy has basically, he's holding what amounts to a hand blender, a great big hand blender made out of an old washing machine motor. And this was the very first mixed farm we went to, and they were harvesting tomatoes and then turning it into a value-added product. So he was cooking the tomatoes in a big pot on an open fire, and then he'd take the hand blender and blend them all up. And there's also a ram pump that we saw on the Casimiro farm. That was the permaculture farm run by the family. And apparently they've been used in Saskatchewan. I had never heard of them before. Have you heard of them, Kim? Anybody else heard of them?
I've heard of them before. Cuba. Yeah. But through a permaculture course. Not Cuba.
Yeah. So they don't use any electricity or anything like that to power them. It's actually used. They use hydraulic power, and it only works where you have falling water. And the idea is it takes a large volume of water and then uses the energy of it falling to effectively build up pressure in an air chamber like this. And then what happens is water gets released out of here, a spillover valve, which then closes, forces pressure, and then it forces the water up this pipe. So you have a drive pipe with water coming downhill and into here, and it forces up this valve, and then there's a backflow valve here, builds up pressure and pushes it on. So you can actually, with 1 meter fall of water down this drive shaft, you can move water up 40 meters. That's quite remarkable. So on the Casimiro farm, they had a spring bed pond, which they had widened, and then they had gone down an embankment and put the ram pump down at the bottom and were running water down through there. And what was really interesting is that because of the way it operates here, not all the water gets moved on. If you had an electric pump, every drop of water would be moved on and through the system. But the ram pump only passes some of the water on, and so they were able to take water out of this spring and use it for their needs, but pass the spring along through the natural systems to the neighbors. So I just had a short video of the experiment. So you can see the water sort of spreading out through that valve. So it's then pumping it uphill, and it went something like 200 meters, 250 meters up to the top of the farm.
So there's a series of these?
No,
it just went up, and then it went through this, through that block pipe that was very narrow, and that pipe went all the way up to the top of the farm, and then the water sort of trickled down here.
Yeah, they had a big holding tank at the top.
The pump's pushing the water through that.
Through this blood pipe, it gets pushed up.
And so they had this big holding tank down at the other end of the farm, and the water would just be delivered via gravity as they needed it for irrigation through it.
Another thing that we noticed at a lot of farms was the use of biogas. So here, this is the Casimiro farm, the same farm where they had the ram farm. And they would basically collect animal waste, I think mainly, in a pond, and then as it fermented, the gas would get collected, But no gas was like coming, like it looks like a surface, but it was actually, but no gas was coming off into the air. Like you didn't smell the gas. It would get collected and then piped off to the house or to wherever they wanted to use it. And so other farms would have a system where you could pipe it off and then use it in the kitchen to cook food, was the usual system. And so there is showing how there's like a film on top to keep the gas from escaping out. And then they, once it had fermented, then this water was used as kind of a fertilizer, so it ran out into some of the crops farther down. And then here was an example of things being kind of scary. So this is just a plastic bag, like it's just a thin layer of plastic, and inside that is methane gas. So what's scary about it is imagine if someone lit a match too close. So this is on the research station, actually, not on the Casimir farm, but they had a biogas production, and then they stored it here, and then piped it off into the kitchen. And then another thing that was on pretty much every site we visited was vermicomposting. Vermicomposting is worm composting. And it was usually in really large beds like this. So here you can see like this heather and other people in our group all looking at this bed, and then close up, it's all full of worms. And it would be things like animal waste or organic matter or like plants, like plant cuttings or food waste would go into this, and then it would be used for fertilizer. And this is something that that since the special period the government has really been encouraging, so it's really, really widely used. And then propagating mycorrhizae, which is really remarkable because mycorrhizae are fungi that colonize plant roots, and they're in something like 80% of plant species that have mycorrhizae. But what's notable about it is mycorrhizae can't be grown outside of plants. If you try to grow them on artificial media, they won't grow unless there's a plant there. So that means that, like in Canada, there are some companies that sell mycorrhizae inoculants because in fields that are plowed with machinery or where pesticides and fertilizers are used, that really suppresses mycorrhizae, and since mycorrhizae help plants absorb nutrients and water from the soil, then plants do less well without them. So then in Canada, you can buy mycorrhizae inoculants that every year you pay money and you apply it, but it is kind of viewed as something that can't be done for people to grow their own mycorrhizae. But here on the organic monaco in Havana, then this farm was actually growing their own mycorrhizae by growing it on a plant in the ground and then harvesting the plant and using it, I think, for animal feed, but then cutting the roots and drying the roots and grinding them up and then using that as an inoculant that they would then put that in peat pellets and re-inoculate other plants. So they had a system that could be done right on the farm. And then another thing that really stuck out for me was this one type of efficient microorganisms that were the way that a culture would be started is you would go to a local area where there was healthy plants, a healthy ecosystem, and collect like the very top layer of soil that's dead leaves or freshly fallen organic matter, and collect that and put it in a barrel with growth media that was things like honey and molasses, and grow that in a barrel for a period of time, and then use that as kind of a starting material for inoculants. So it was, and it was really widely used, and was a mixture of many, many different microorganisms. It was being studied at the research station, but it still wasn't, like, it was a mixture of like fungi and bacteria, but all of the organisms involved aren't yet totally known. And here's just someone holding some of the inoculant in their hand. And back to you.
Actually, that just reminded me, because the first place we found out about these efficient microorganisms, the fellow doing that was an engineer. Mm-hmm. And we found a lot of these people who had a professional degree in something like that, lawyers, engineers, doctors, had gone over to agriculture. This is just a really interesting example of Cuba's foreign policy. What they're doing is they're providing aid to other countries in the form of trained medical professionals, whether they're from Cuba or from elsewhere. So we were just driving outside of Havana and just saw in the middle of nowhere this great big complex. It looked like a big apartment block. And it turned out it was this Latin American school of medicine that the government established in 1999. It was actually in response to a couple of hurricanes in the area that year that affected other countries, and they wanted to be able to provide medical aid to those countries. So what they do is they offer a scholarship that includes a tuition, a room and board, and a small stipend to students largely from Latin America, the Caribbean. There are some African students, and also I think about 90 American students. And the idea is that they work for 2 years in the Cuban medical system, and then they go back to where they came from and work in areas that are medically underserved in their own countries. And so they're particularly interested in students who are willing to make that commitment, and to students who don't have the financial resources in their own countries to go to medical school as well. So we had heard, in fact, that Cuba exports more medical personnel to the developing world than all the G8 countries combined, and I sort of was looking around for a source and I found it last night.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it is true. So that's what some people are touting as the contribution that Cuba is making to the world. And then, of course, the other side of the story is that there are people who are saying that Cuban doctors are basically held hostage. They're allowed to go to these foreign countries, but they can't take their family with them because they're afraid they're not going to return, and that they're working there on slave wages. So it's kind of a mixed story, I think.
Mm-hmm. We heard that professional people will work at the resort.
Yes.
Where they can get tips. Money,
yeah.
Rather than work at professional.
Yes. Yeah, because of the two currencies that they have. If you can earn a wage or tips in the tourist dollars, you can buy a lot more with that currency than you can with the national.
Well, and even the iTour guide, our group, we had to have a Cuban tourist organization go with us, and so the Cuban guide who's with us, that he said he'd gone to university and he used to work as a teacher, as an English teacher, so he spoke very, very good English. But then he could make a lot more money working for this tourist company, guiding tourists around, than he could working as a teacher. Mm-hmm. So that's an example of people who would leave a professional job that you've gone to university and done a lot of training to do because you can make more money in the tourist industry.
Yeah, that's true for a lot of people. This is something that somebody brought to my attention before I left for Cuba, actually. Over here on the y-axis is the UN's Human Development Index. So the higher you go on the scale, so the more developed a country is in terms of its ability to provide its citizens with what makes for sort of quality, healthy human life. And you can see right here, the threshold for high human development is 0.8, so this line here. And then on the x-axis is ecological footprint for each country. And so you'll notice that there are all these of this pattern where developing countries tend to be down here with a low ecological footprint, but they still can't provide some of the basic necessities to their citizens. And then here we are up here, and we have a really high ecological footprint, but we have all the good things in life. And here's Cuba. So they've got the quality of life that the UN says everybody's entitled to, but they have a really low ecological footprint. And people are not well off, obviously. But the basic necessities are being met.
So then that's it for our presentation, and then this is a photo that I took last summer of the behind the family residences on the campus here, and a community garden that's being started. And so we went to Cuba to learn about how countries can respond to peak oil and how agriculture can be more sustainable, and then we want to bring back some of what we learned and apply it to Canada. And obviously some things can't be applied, like specific plants, like growing pineapple or banana, but some things could, like having urban agriculture or using composting or things like that. So that's it, I guess.
Do you know the history of permaculture in Cuba? How it was introduced, or how widely it is accepted or used?
We definitely had a presentation about that. We went to what's his name, Roberto Perez.
Yeah.
It was gave us a presentation on that topic, and I don't remember the dates of it, but it was in. They learned, like, permaculture was developed in Australia, obviously, to begin with, and so they learned some Australians came to Cuba. And I just don't remember the year when they first came. And I mean, it's still not, it's still like organoponicals without any permaculture knowledge are much, much more common than organoponicals where permaculture is being applied, or organic farming is much more common than using permaculture. Mm-hmm. And then some people like the Casimiro farm, that they developed this farm.